Welcome to Season 3 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, I speak to Dr. Jonathan Quick, the Managing Director for Pandemic Preparedness, Response, and Prevention at the Rockefeller Foundation. Our topic is genomic surveillance, why it's important, how to do it well, and why it must cover the globe. Let's listen. Dr. Quick, thank you so much for joining me today. You are involved in this new report from the Rockefeller Foundation called Getting Ahead of the Pandemic, Accelerating National Genomic Surveillance. Let me start with a question. What are we looking for with national genomic surveillance, and why is that important?
Well, first of all, it's good to be with you, Professor Sharfstein, and look forward to the conversation. Whenever you have a virus, particularly a pandemic virus, it's going to mutate. The genes will change. And when you get enough of those changes to change the behavior of the virus, that's called a variant. So what we've seen now, although the coronavirus mutates much less than the flu virus or the AIDS virus, it mutates. And with basically an out-of-control pandemic in many parts of the world still, we're starting to see new variants. And the ones that we're most concerned about, and the reason why we want to be looking for the variants, the ones we're most worried about is the UK one, the one identified in the UK, which was behind surges in Europe in January. And that did two things. With a variant, you worry about, will it make it more contagious? The answer for that variant, the British one, was yes, 50% on average. Will it be more deadly? Are you more likely to die if you have it? And the answer again for that variant is yes, again, about 50%. The third question is whether it will interfere with the effectiveness of vaccines or the effectiveness of treatments. And for the variant that's come from South Africa, the answer to that, unfortunately, is yes. It reduces the effectiveness of at least some of the vaccines.
So essentially, you're saying that we're in this battle with this virus. The virus is changing. We have to understand how it's changing in order to respond.
Exactly. Yes. And the way to do that is to be able to monitor the changes in the virus. We call that genomic surveillance. It's surveillance just like you do for any disease, but for the genome. What's happening to the genes of the virus?
Let me ask you this. How do we figure out what's happening to the genes of the virus? You know, that there's a test to figure out whether it's SARS-CoV-2, whether someone has the coronavirus. What other test has to be done to really look at the genes?
So think of it this way. The genes are the fingerprints. And it's actually easy to collect the fingerprints. Every time you get a positive PCR test, you can actually get the genetic fingerprint. The tricky thing is to connect those fingerprints to a crime, that is, to greater deadliness or contagiousness. And what that takes is a combination of work in the petri dish, work with animals in the lab, and then human epidemiology to see when you have a surge that's associated with a new strain, as we saw in the UK, then the epidemiology showed that it was very clearly associated with that new fingerprint, that new genetic fingerprint.
So what you're saying is that just sequencing these viral strains and knowing whether there's a variant, that's only part of the story. You also have to know how sick the patients are, where they are from, maybe whether they've been treated with medicines, a whole bunch of things to really see not just the variants, but the threat that they pose.
Exactly. And then the thing is, once you know that a particular variant is posing that threat, you want to know where it's traveling, how it's getting there, and how much penetration it has into the population. So in the U.S. right now, we're all kind of sitting back and saying, oh, curve's going down, things are fine, you know, sunny skies ahead. But what we've seen with this British variant is when that takes off, when it gets past about 50% of the new cases, it really explodes. And it's a game changer for countries as like UK, like the Netherlands, like a number of countries in Europe. Right now, we're at that tipping point because in the US, by CDC estimates, 30% of our new cases are from that British variant, the more contagious variant. So we're at a tipping point, which puts us in a race between scaling up vaccination and the virus, and who's going to get ahead first.
Got it. Now, what does it take to do good surveillance of these variants? What is the Rockefeller Foundation recommending?
So the key thing, it's really the core of it is building a viral defense system. And what that means is that we need to have a program of random sampling, at least 3%, ideally 5% of the positive PCR tests. You do need to do those lab-based molecular tests because that's how you get the genes. That needs to be throughout the country. Right now, we have much more intensive surveillance within certain states like California and Florida and Massachusetts. So you have to be sampling through your public health system in your clinical labs. You need to get that to a university or a company that can actually do the sequence. Then you need to put that, just like you do with fingerprints, to Washington. You need to get that into a repository. And then you need to be able to connect that with research centers in order to, as we say, connect the dots so that we can ask the so what question. That is, does it affect contagiousness? Does it affect deadliness? Or does it affect vaccine effectiveness?
So it's about collecting the data, but also sharing the data.
Exactly.
And making sure that there are people who have a lot of epidemiology skills, different kinds of skills, can really use the data to answer these critically important questions.
Right. And this takes a good collaboration and work between the CDC and the state labs and the university centers, the academic centers in the private sector. And it's stitching together all those different working parts into a really efficient system that's of the scale and speed that we need.
Now, your report also talks about the equity dimension to this kind of testing. Could you tell me what that's about?
Yeah, so one of the issues that we've had throughout the pandemic, and the pandemic really has revealed the deadly consequences of the inequities within the U.S. health system and health systems in many parts of the world in terms of access to care, preventive care, and diagnostics and all among different ethnic and racial groups. And we know that the Black population is dying at a much higher rate. They're getting tested at a lower rate. They're getting vaccinated at a lower rate. So when we're looking at this surveillance, it comes out of the testing. So if we're under testing at-risk communities, then we're not seeing the full spread of the new variants.
So it's really important that the surveillance cover everywhere the virus is.
Exactly.
Great. So looking ahead for a minute, we're in this battle with the virus. It's a race to get people vaccinated. Genomic surveillance is going to be important over the long term because you're worried not just about this current battle, but the full, I don't know if I'm extending the metaphor here, but the full war with this virus and all the battles that could yet come, other variants coming down the pike. How do you see the role of genomic surveillance fitting into the bigger picture? And I say that knowing that you were the author of a book entitled The End of Epidemics, The Looming Threat to Humanity and How to Stop It. So I know this is something you've thought about.
The fact that the virus can change anytime, and is that we've had at least now a half a dozen significant changes, it has to be part of our routine testing everywhere, worldwide, to keep up with the virus and to adjust our vaccines and our treatments. And it changes the game in terms of how we think about the global vaccination. We can't anymore, and I don't think we ever were, but some people are thinking of it in terms of, okay, we have the money, we vaccinate the global north, we will, as a humanitarian thing, vaccinate the global south as much as we can, we've got to get vaccination up everywhere. And that's a real equity issue.
In other words, if I could just break in for a second, in other words, you're saying if we leave a lot of countries unvaccinated, you could get a variant developing that really undermines the entire global response.
Yes, that's exactly it. And we've done a projection. I mean, this is hard to, you know, the virus is mercurial, so anything is rough. But if we were to get to 80% coverage in the global north and only 20% in the global south, we'd have five times the odds of a variant coming out of the unvaccinated part of the world would be five times that of the vaccinated part of the world. That's sort of simple math, but that's roughly the kind of difference and the kind of threat that's created. And with 10 different kinds of vaccines being used around the world and these variants developing different places, if we don't keep on top of the situation, we may be playing whack-a-mole with this virus for years to come. That's why we have to move from flying blind on genomics to flying really clearly sighted in the U.S. and worldwide.
So in a way, this is a critical piece, but it's a piece of a response that really depends on both equity and access to genomic testing, equity and access to the vaccine, and kind of a coherent global response where it's humanity against a virus.
Yeah. And so you mentioned the end of epidemics. And in that book, what we tried to do is look back at the last century of pandemics and say, what would it take to keep these local disease outbreaks, which are always going to happen, from spiraling into catastrophic pandemics? And we came up with seven key actions. I won't go through all of them, but pretty common sense, but well evidenced. Leadership was number one, and we've seen what happens without that. Really wise investment and all in the right technologies, good advocacy. But when I look at how we've responded, what not I, nor I don't think any of the others writing about this really saw, was what happens when you don't connect the questions that epidemiologists know need to be answered to fight the pandemic with good science to answer those questions, with good behavior change communication to get the changes in the population you need. And over again, the questions that the scientists had in their mind weren't answered quickly enough. And when they were, the communication didn't go well.
Right. So, yeah, that gives a sense of, in this particular area, what needs to happen. We know the scientific questions about variants, but we need the data to answer it, and we have to be able to use that data.
Exactly. But we need to do that with everything. With masks, it's amazing we're a year into it and just trying to get the science. With aerosol, we got the science right 8 months ago and are still fumbling the communications. So at Rockefeller, we're absolutely determined to get the science and the communication and the action right around genomic surveillance, because so much is at stake. And so the whole purpose of this action plan that was released a week ago and the accompanying framework for implementation is to get the system up, both in the U.S. and worldwide, that we know is needed to defend against the inevitable variants that are going to come and do us harm by being more contagious, more deadly, or will elude our natural defenses, our vaccines, or our treatments.
Dr. Quick, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you, Dr. Sharfstein.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outland. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holes Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.